Yeah, in 3 seconds.
Good evening, everyone. A very warm welcome to all of you who have joined us today for the 20th webinar of our series O2S. 20 weeks back when we had started this series of webinar done by Dr. Jaydeep Tang sir, whose brainchild this is, co-curated by Dr. Parikshit Tang sir, myself, Dr. Apurva, Dr. Rohan, Dr. Niharika, and Dr. Priyankur, who've been helping him in this series. We started off with about 2,500 delegates across the country and internationally as well. And today it gives me immense pleasure in telling you all that we stand at 5,067 delegates who are currently logged in to our series of webinars. And this is possible only because of the excellent lectures that have been delivered by so many faculty across these 20 weeks. And it has been possible because the entire program was initiated in the first week when we started itself. We had the entire program, what was supposed to happen even by the 23rd week, done by Jaydeep sir. And so it really gives me such a pleasure to be a part of this series. And today to start our 20th webinar, I have none other than Dr. Kurian Joseph sir. Sir requires no introduction at all. He is one of the pioneers in laparoscopic surgery, one of the very few people who have excelled laparoscopy in during times when people who did not know the meaning of laparoscopy itself. And an excellent teacher who's been able to train so many more endoscopic surgeons over the years. Sir's lectures and everything, of course, I'm sure all of you have heard are... they kind of just leave such a huge mark for you. I request Kurian Joseph sir to give us the welcome speech for our 20th webinar of O2S.
Thank you. You can hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, doctor.
Thanks for the invitation. I'm very happy to be amongst you. Thanks, Jaydeep, Parikshit, and team for inviting me here. Greetings to the audience. I never knew I'm talking to so many people who are sitting here to listen to this. I'm very, very impressed. O2S, looking forward statement is what I've been asked to say. I was just given this intimation yesterday, so I'm really looking forward to know what I'm going to say. Now, anytime you're looking forward, remember you have to look back to look forward. And that's one of the very important principles in anything, even in love and war. You have to look back and then look forward. When you look back, the term obstetrics means a midwife. They say it came from the word obstare, where the obstetrician or the midwife would stand before a woman. So upstairs. And what was the midwife? Midwife again just meant to be with woman. So the man, the woman with the woman was usually one of the elder women or the priestesses or one of the senior medicine women who could look after the woman. This field of obstetrics was taught in medical schools only by the 20th century. And till then, we were managing with just hearsay or word of mouth talk. Writings of Hippocrates, there are writings in Sanskrit, there are writings in German, all on obstetrics. But the very important crux of the entire story of midwife, of obstetrics, is that the midwife considers the miracle of childbirth as normal and leaves it alone unless there is trouble. Whereas the doctor considers this to be trouble if he or she does not intervene. So this is the crux. We are between Scylla and Charybdis. One side, the devil and the deep sea. One side, we have to take the bull by its horns. Wait and watch or active management. This still continues to bug us right throughout. I'm sure many of you have were taught the principle of watchful expectancy and masterly inactivity. I can tell you a story of watchful expectancy. Mauricio, of the famous Mauricio Smelly White, he was an expert of active management. His own sister went into labor with placenta previa in pre-cesarean days. And he wanted to take the baby out. Everybody told him, wait, wait, wait. So they kept watching till finally he got impatient. He put his hand in, did a podalic version, delivered the baby out, and baby came out, yes, but his sister died. So this is the story. Watchful expectancy versus masterly inactivity. Do we watch and wait, or do we treat and cure? This goes on in modern times, and even in today's times, the lecture by Jaydeep basically is going to emphasize on these points. But today we live in a time of data crunching. We've got numbers, we've got percentages, we've got figures on LSCS rates, we've got figures on instrumental delivery rates, we've got figures on maternal mortality. We are all married to such figures, but like all marriages, some of these figures can be very troublesome. And that is what we have to be very careful about. There is no absolute, there is no ideal. All these are based on circumstances. So we have to take it with a grain of salt, as they say, or as they say in words, evidence-based medicine, decide whether to take it or not. And with this, we will land up with a healthy baby and a healthy mother. So when you say looking forward, O to S, I just looked at the alphabets. Between O and S, we have a very important segment. It's the P, Q, and R. So if you take P, Q, and R, in P, we have to have an obstetrician who's passionate, an obstetrician who's precise, and most important, an obstetrician who's patient. In Q, we have to have an obstetrician who respects quality and delivers only quality. And finally, in R, we have to have an obstetrician who reads and also and indulges in research to practice what he's learned. So if you follow this PQR, you automatically get from O to S. So by doing O to S and listening to these lovely lectures, I hope you succeed and spread happiness to the moms all over and have many nice babies coming out with their lusty cries. So thank you very much for giving me this opportunity and all the best to your team. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Kurian. It's always such a pleasure to listen to you. On a personal note, the first time I met Dr. Kurian was when I attended my first ever AICOG in Chennai, I think it was in 92, when Dr. Sirish Sheth got installed, and Dr. Joseph Kurian at that time was the master of ceremonies for the inauguration. And since then, of course, Dr. Kurian has reached such wonderful heights. He's only the third ever Indian to have been the president of the Asia Oceania Federation of Obstetrics and Gynecology. It's a federation which encompasses 27 countries, starting from Australia, New Zealand, Japan, all the way to the now very infamous Suez Canal. And if I may say so, Dr. Kurian, pardon me for the pun, but you are one person I know who is evergreen. Just because I said Suez Canal, I had to say that. Dr. Kurian is one person who, despite all his accomplishments, is really very, very grounded, very down to earth. It's always such a pleasure to sit with him. And for those who may not know, he's absolutely delightful company, besides all his academic achievements. So thank you very much, Dr. Kurian, for being there. And thank you very much for those inspiring words. Apurva, we can move on now. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Thank you so much, Kurian, sir. And thank you, Jaideep, sir. It's always great to kind of hear the anecdotes of all the great speakers that we've had. Let's us a little insight into their personal life as well, apart from the professional this thing. It's a sheer pleasure to have you, Kurian, sir. I know it was a little last minute, but we always had you in the top preference, and we wanted to make sure that we had you on the 5,000 mark for us when we have so many audience. Thank you so much for being here, sir. Moving on to the program today, I think our first speaker, that is Dr. Jaideep Pant, sir, requires no introduction. All of you know how sir has been curating and moderating all the sessions over the past 20 weeks. But just a brief intro for people who have joined. Sir is currently the FOCSI Secretary General. And the amount of work I think sir has put into FOCSI over the last couple of years, especially with respect to multiple acts, even with respect to the MTP Act and the PCPMDT Act, sir has done tremendous work, and we hope that that's going to really reflect a lot into the future practice of all the obstetricians to come. And today, sir, we'll be talking on a very important topic, that is augmentation of labor in modern times. As Kurian sir has said, we just need to see now if we are going to use a hands-on approach or we will be using a hands-off approach. Over to you, Jaideep, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Apurva. And I would like to welcome everybody who's logged into this very special edition of the O2S Obstetric Masterclass for two reasons. One, that this is the 20th in the series, which means we have actually completed two decades, if I may say so, of the O2S series. And secondly, this is the first time we have more than 5,000 viewers logged in for this web CAB. We currently have 5,067 delegates logged in for this program. It's of course also very special because, as I just said, Dr. Kurian is here, and one of my closest friends, Nozer, is here. You know, Nozer is almost a decade senior to me, but he has always indulged me so much, and he's never treated me like a junior. And I think that speaks to his ability really to maintain relationships, if I may say so. And besides, of course, all his academic brilliance, besides his surgical brilliance, some of which will be evident in the talk that he's about to give, let me also say that Nozer is really one of our foremost advocates for women's health, and particularly sexual and reproductive health rights. Nozer, it's always such a pleasure to listen to you, and thank you very much for accepting this invitation. We also have an absolutely fantastic panel. It's going to be very interesting, and it's going to be moderated by my very, very dear friend, Dr. Palani Appan from Chennai. And he's got this wonderful batch of panelists. It's always great to see Palani, and I know that the panel is going to be absolutely wonderful because he's such a fine moderator who brings out points with nuance, with humor, and with the kind of take-home messages that only he can. He, of course, has a very, very fine panel of Dr. Renu Makwana, Dr. Leela Vyas, Dr. Preeti Jindal, Pranjal, Prerna, Dr. Panda, and Neeraj, who is doing such a fantastic job as chair of the Sexual Medicine Committee. So let me jump right into my topic of augmentation of labor in modern times. And if we are talking about modern times, really speaking, we cannot but escape this feeling that my dream is that every woman everywhere will know the joy of a truly safe, comfortable, and satisfying birthing for herself and her baby. And if you keep this context in mind, you will realize why augmentation of labor at times is so important for having a good and a satisfying outcome for the patient. The other reason that this topic is important is simply because it is so common. Oxytocin, for the purpose of augmentation and induction, is actually one of the most frequently used medications in obstetrics, with over half of all women in labor receiving oxytocin augmentation worldwide. This, of course, differs between countries, within the same country, within the same hospital, and oftentimes within the same units. But the fact remains that augmentation of labor is something that we as obstetricians live with day in and day out. And these are the talking points of the presentation. When should we augment? How should we augment? And when should we stop the augmentation and decide that we need now to call it a day? So to decide when to start augmentation, I think the primary thing is to decide your starting point of when labor begins. And I think there is so much disagreement on this as to when exactly labor begins, particularly in the very early stages of labor when patients are less than 2 or 3 centimeters, that it's fair to say that the diagnosis of the onset of labor is, in fact, although self-evident sometimes, quite difficult the other times, because there are many different patterns according to the parity and the individual woman. In fact, I would say that the diagnosis of labor is probably more challenging in multiparous women with very patulous os. They sometimes are maybe a 1.5, 2 to 3 centimeters dilated even without the onset of labor. So when they start having pain, are they really in labor? Are they false uterine contractions? You don't know, and it's important to know, of course, because what you intervene will depend on whether you think that the patient is in labor or not. Why should we augment labor? Well, there are many, many different reasons, and unfortunately, not all the reasons are supported by the best available research evidence. Indications to augment labor range from organizational aspects to overcome busy labor ward, trying to avoid a long duration of a painful experience, but remember that you are trading them off with a more intense pain to avoid a prolonged stress to the fetus, but more frequent contractions sometimes increase. And finally, to reduce rates of cesarean sections by avoiding C-sections for prolonged labor. It is also a truism that the longer the labor lasts, it is a more negative birth experience for the patient. So you could say, in some fairness, that augmentation of labor done in a reasonable way, in at a reasonable time, is actually augmenting not only the labor, but the birth experience of that patient. Who augments labors more? Clinicians with more post-qualification experience, that is the senior, consider the minimal acceptable progress to be faster than those with fewer years of experience. So this study from Australia shows that more junior Australian doctors and doctors who were working in higher levels of hospitals like tertiary care hospitals tend to augment labor more often than doctors who are senior. And I think that speaks to what Dr. Kurian said about patients. So where did this whole concept about augmenting labor get institutionalized? It was Karen Ho Driscoll from Ireland who actually started implementing a strategy to reduce the incidence of prolonged labor. At that time, in 1963, the definition of prolonged labor was 36 hours or more. And he sort of instituted an approach of active management by which it was possible to reduce the definition of prolonged labor to 12 hours by the early 70s. Philpott, Castle, and Studd also advocated a similar approach. And what they all had to say was that active management of labor is not only augmentation of labor. there are two concepts in the active management. There's an organizational concept, which looks at the broader part of making a more positive birth experience, like antenatal education classes, one-to-one midwifery care, etc. And then the medical component, as I already said, which focuses on the correct diagnosis of labor. And this really is key. Selective admission, use of partogram, and augmentation in slow progress. So when do we want to augment labor? We would like to augment labor when the cervix is not dilating, the head is not descending, and effacement is inadequate. So it's always a very easy decision, if I may say so, when the contractions are not very good. However, the decision to augment the labor is governed primarily by the dynamic effects of the uterine activity, that is, by the rate of dilatation and after a careful assessment of the pelvis and fetal presentation. It is, however, a more difficult decision to decide to start oxytocin when there is slow progress but apparently normal contractions. The thought is that in this instance, perhaps the contractions are causing dysfunctional labor, and augmenting that labor with oxytocin could help in making the contractions better and then causing a better dilatation of the cervix. Should you augment a patient in the latent phase of labor? Let's remember that the mainstay of the management of a prolonged latent phase is to avoid unnecessary intervention. If at all you decide to augment when the patient is in the latent phase of labor, it should be based on a very clear indication, since if you augment the labor in the latent phase, you are actually increasing the risk of cesarean section. Which brings us to this whole very, very large debate on what exactly constitutes the latent phase of labor. And this controversy actually started way back when Friedman, in fact, I don't know whether you're aware, but it's an interesting piece of history that Friedman was not allowed to attend the birth of his child, of his first child, because they said, you are the father and we will not allow you in. So he went back to his hospital, Columbia, and he saw that there were 12 patients laboring. And because he didn't have anything else to do and he was worried about whether his wife would deliver properly or not, he started plotting the labor curve of these 12 women who were in labor at that time in the labor room. And when he plotted the labor curve of these 12 women, he came to this famous sigmoid curve of labor. He thought that it was interesting that 12 women exhibited a similar pattern of their labor curve. And therefore, he did his first study consisting of around 100 women and published this paper in 1954 on a normal labor curve. Since then, there has been a lot of discussion on what actually constitutes latent phase, what constitutes active phase. The WHO came up with that partogram, and now we know from Zhang's literature, Zhang's studies, that perhaps labor behaves differently at different parities. So that's P0, P1, and P2 in the graph at the bottom. And latent phase of labor, or labor up to almost 6 centimeters, could sometimes, particularly in primipare, take much longer than we thought that it would. And therefore, the time when we have to intervene and augment labor is keeping on getting pushed further and further. So if you are going to augment in the active phase of labor, remember that the reference to a cervical dilatation of 1 centimeter per hour is no longer recommended. In fact, the question then arises, what is the practical alternative? So if you are seeing a slow progression, assess the situation carefully, because the frequency of contractions is only one of the variables to be considered. Look at the maternal fetal well-being, position of the fetus, and suspicion of cephalopelvic disproportion, and then only go ahead and then augment the labor. If you're going to augment the labor, how are you going to do it? The most commonly done way of augmenting of labor is in fact amniotomy, or what we like to call ARM, or artificial rupture of membrane. It is thought that the rupture of intact membrane itself augments uterine contractions, therefore preventing or treating a delay in the first stage. Of course, it also has the added advantage that it allows you to inspect the nature of the lichen, whether there is meconium or no meconium. But I will caution you against too early an ARM, particularly in the absence of high risk factors, because the longer the time patient spends with an ARM, the higher is the incidence of FHR abnormalities and infectious morbidity. So again, there is a lot of literature, and what is clear from the literature of amniotomy, that's ARM versus expectant management, is that patients who undergo an ARM at the suitable time have a shorter duration of labor than patients who do not have the ARM. If you look at ARM and oxytocin versus oxytocin, ARM versus ARM plus oxytocin, and ARM and oxytocin versus delayed amniotomy with oxytocin, everywhere you will find that doing the ARM does shorten the course of labor. However, again, a word of caution that don't do the ARM too early. If you do the ARM too early, when the patient is not ready or is not already in an active phase of labor, the patient will have to spend a longer time, because once you do the ARM, in a sense, the clock really starts ticking, as it does when you start oxytocin. And like so many other things in medicine, I think the decision to start oxytocin is actually a very, very important decision, which I find is sometimes taken a little lightly. Just like ARM, once you start oxytocin, that labor goes on a clock, and there is a lot of pressure to end the labor one way or another. And therefore, starting oxytocin should never be taken very lightly. You need to have a proper reason to start oxytocin, and it's always a good idea to document that reason in the patient's paper before you start oxytocin for augmentation. Once you start it, you have to titrate it in an arithmetical or a geometric manner, starting from a low dose. Ideally, intravenous oxytocin should always be administered using a peristaltic infusion pump, a syringe pump, or even a pump, which is taken through a bag. The RCOG now recommends that oxytocin should not be administered by gravity-fed drips, because they are unreliable and potentially safe, which could cause uterine hyperstimulation, while a suboptimal dose may lead to a false diagnosis of progress and cesarean section. We have now moved to using an infusion pump, and this is what we have on the wall of our labor room. Although now everybody is very used to using the infusion pump, I've always found it useful to put up these things in the labor room where they are easily visible. And even somebody who is new to the labor room can look at it and make sure that the right thing is done. So the settings actually depend on the syringe that you use, on the dilution, and so on and so forth. But once you get used to it, it's not really that difficult to do it. Unfortunately, there is really no consensus on how to give oxytocin in terms of initial dose, in terms of when to increase the dose, how much to increase the dose, and what the maximum dose can be used. Different oxytocin regimens are used within the same maternity unit sometimes. And as you will see here, every country seems to have a completely different way of giving oxytocin. Be as it may, the principle of first do no harm is what should be paramount when you are talking about augmentation of labor. What about comparison of oxytocin with delayed treatment? There is absolutely no doubt that augmentation of labor in the right circumstances does shorten. Should you use a high dose or a low dose? Always the lowest possible dose is what is recommended to prevent hyperstimulation of the uterus. And then if you are looking at comparing whether to increase oxytocin rapidly or whether to increase it in gradual intervals, remember that increasing the rate more frequently may be associated with more uterine hyperstimulation. The question then is, what is your endpoint, or how do you decide that this is what I want from my oxytocin titration? We have classically been told 3 by 10 by 30, 3 contractions in 10 minutes lasting for at least 30 seconds to maybe a minute. However, always remember that there is actually insufficient evidence regarding the level of uterine activity that should be produced, I would have to say that what activity is produced should be calibrated against the response of the cervix. If she is dilating well with 2 by 10 by 30, then that's good enough for her. There is no need to increase the dose. So you need to have a situational awareness, if I may say so, before you decide to step up the dose of oxytocin. How long should you give oxytocin? Well, there is really no consensus. Is it 3 hours, 4 hours, 5 hours, or 6 hours? At one point in time, we used to give oxytocin till there was either fetal distress or the at least 6 hours of oxytocin had run out. As time goes by, our threshold for administration of oxytocin is reducing. And if we want to keep cesarean section rates in check, again, remember that the decision to start oxytocin should not be taken very lightly. We routinely give oxytocin for women with epidural analgesia. If we feel that she has adequate uterine activity, we give a very small dose, but we think that using oxytocin for women with epidural analgesia does enhance the labor. A confession here, I'm going to stick my neck out and say, I don't do VBAC. However, literature seems to suggest that in certain circumstances, it may actually be useful to use oxytocin even in patients where you're trying for a VBAC. And of course, you must try and use the least possible dose. Every labor room has its own, what I like to call masala, for trying to get the labor over earlier, starting from antispasmodics to IV fluids, to misoprostol in a small dose, or even the routine use of enemas. I think although there is some very little evidence to show the utility of antispasmodics, that's probably the most common practice. Tell you the truth, I'm not really very fond of antispasmodics because sometimes I have seen patients really get lightheaded, etc. with them, and that leads to a very uncomfortable experience for the patient. Literature seems to suggest that giving a IV fluids or the routine use of enema is not really very useful. Currently, we are not using oral or vaginal misoprostol for the induction of labor at term, except when there is an IUFD, simply because we aren't really sure about the doses that are required and we are worried about uterine hyperstimulation. Always remember that once you start an oxytocin, you are doing an intervention. It is not something as simple as just starting an IV fluid, and make sure that your documentation is absolutely proper to avoid any medico-legal issues. So to conclude, cervical dilatation over time as an isolated indicator may not really always be used to define labor arrest. Other parameters such as frequency and duration, effacement and fetal station need to be considered. Labor progression should be thought as a hyperbolic process rather than a linear process, with the inflection point close to 5 centimeter dilatation according to the studies by Zhang. And always remember that having a faster or a slower labor does not assure better birth outcomes, as the natural labor process could be different for each woman. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Jaideep sir. I think as much as I've loved the lecture, I even loved the image that says, 12 hours of labor, I'm going to hear about it for the rest of our lives. I think all of us, whoever have been born through vaginal delivery, know that how our moms have been about it and how they talk about it. That was definitely an amazing lecture. So for all our audience, if they have any questions regarding the topic, please go ahead and mention your city, state, and shoot out all your questions. We'll be more than happy to answer them in our question answer sessions. Moving on to our next topic, we are very, very particular about time in all our series, and we're maintaining excellent timing right now. So let me request our next speaker for the day, Dr. Noser Sirid sir, to take over the session. Again, Dr. Noser sir, as Dr. Jaideep sir has already told, he's an extremely intelligent and smart and very, very articulate. And, no matter what sir is telling, I think we just feel like listening to it. And I've had the privilege of listening to sir both professionally and personally with respect to his dialect and everything else. Today, sir is going to talk about another topic which is very relevant to what Jaideep sir has said. With respect to normal delivery, what we are doing to augment the labor. And if we, you know, we always feel that cesarean section is going to be our salvaging point. And, you know, if something happens in normal, we can always go back to a section. But how are we going to feel when you actually have difficulty in delivering a cesarean? I think that is the actual nightmare for a lot of obstetricians. So no better person than Noza sir to talk about it. The stage is all yours, sir.
Thank you so much, Apurva. Really a privilege to be part of this program. Firstly, because it's a landmark. 5,000 people is something that's truly remarkable. And I'm telling you, it's made me completely change my opinion about reaching out to people. You can be where you are. I miss meeting people in person, but hey, you reach out to so many more. So that's totally great. I'm going to start with sharing my screen. What's also great for me is I have two people today, Kurian and Jaideep, who are both very special to me. I have this very close band of friends, group of friends in Foxy, whom I tremendously respect and love, and both of them, the no-nonsense Kurian Joseph and Jaideep, who's so dependable. I mean, trust me, Jaideep, the years between us just don't matter. You've always been such a close friend and a confidant. And if there's one person who understands me and what I feel about women's health and particularly our passion for ensuring safe abortion, I think you and maybe Atul are the ones who come closest. So thank you very much. I couldn't ever say no to you for speaking in a program. Now, today's topic, Jaideep's was all evidence. Mine is going to be experience. And I'm going to take you on a journey of what challenges we face when we do cesareans. And Abdul Kalam has said, man needs his difficulties because they are necessary to enjoy success. I had published this once a long time ago. This was a cesarean section in antiquity. For me, it's special because Zal, who's supposed to have his wife in prolonged labor, her name is Rudabe, she was post-dated. Just read the words. She had an extraordinary size of baby, he says elephantine. And she wasn't delivering. She was in labor. She was near death. And he calls someone who advises him to perform a C-section, which is called Rustam Zad. And according to the Shahnama, which is a Persian epic, it was probably one of the first C-sections performed. An elephantine baby was delivered, described as a lion. Interestingly, they describe anesthesia. They describe asepsis. So, well, it's something we've been doing for a long time. So can cesarean sections be difficult? And I believe that this is something that constantly demands fine-tuned obstetric skills. I mean, people think you do a C-section, what's so great? Babies just fall out. That's not true. All of us have struggled at C-sections. Why does this happen? Well, firstly, let's face it. We've changed our incisions and we are proud to do very cosmetic fan and steel incisions. You could have difficult access because of a lower segment placenta or fibroids. You could have a floating head. You could have a transverse or a malpresentation, a defect head. Prematurity has become quite a challenge, multiple pregnancy and malformations. So first, I'd like to quote Henry Bergson, who has said, think like a man or woman of action, act like a man or woman of thought. And let's start off with the floating head. Which of us hasn't sweated it out when trying to get a floating head to come to an incision? The anesthetist is pushing, the baby is bobbing all over the place. And this is something I learned very, very early in my practice of obstetrics. One of my bosses, someone very dear to me, once said, even today, I worry about delivering a floating head. And you realize that what happens in this situation is that you need the head to come down, you need to somehow guide it out, and it doesn't always work so easily. So when we are dealing with the floating head, the first thing is make sure you confirm placental location. How many of us really look at an ultrasound report as we go into the operation theater to do a C-section? Very often you anticipate a poorly formed vascular lower segment because when the head is down, that gets taken care of. You manipulate the fetus into a longitudinal lie, support it laterally, someone holding onto it. And then you rupture the membranes and wait for the lica to drain. So the head kind of comes and gets fixed. After that, you can manipulate the head into an occipito anterior posterior position, deliver by vectus forceps or vacuum. I'm going to come to that. But today, when I did a C-section this morning for a polyhydramnios with a floating head, the baby almost bobbed off. And I was prepared to do an internal podalic version and do a breech, but I was able to grab the baby, bring it down and do a forceps delivery. I first started using forceps at C-sections almost 23 years ago. We were doing the Western India trial of the Hayes obstetric forceps, and we started finding newer indications for a C-section. Now, in this particular case, you can see it's quite a large head. It's up there. It's a fan and steel incision. And in this case, you can actually see that one blade is in place. And once you've got this one blade in place, you are using that blade as a kind of a vectus to deliver the head. In this case, it was an occipito posterior. You can do different things with the forceps. And then you could have an abnormal placentation. When you have an anterior placenta, that placenta becomes an obstruction to let the presenting part come to your incision. You may sometimes have to go through the placenta. So first thing you try and do is access the membranes, try and insinuate your fingers between the placenta and the uterine wall, find the membrane somewhere, incise the membrane, push the placenta aside, or if you have no choice, just incise the placenta, get into the amniotic cavity, and you either do an instrumental delivery or a delivery as a breech. In this particular case, there is an alternative, and you can see here the alternative is that we have used a vacuum cup, something that I don't favor, but I have colleagues who do. This is a Birth's cup. Again, when you have a floating head and something that prevents the head to coming to the incision, you can actually use a vacuum cup to guide the baby out. The obstetrician's one request of evolution would have been a handle on the head, and our instruments do that. But you can see why I don't favor the vacuum. It's not always easy to put the vacuum close to the occiput. And because of that, you very often end up deflexing the head when you are performing a vacuum delivery, which is why for me, it's usually the forceps that I prefer. And then we come to the deeply engaged head. Peter Drucker has said, making good decisions is a crucial skill at every level. And in this particular case, you usually have a second stage procedure. You have to be aware of the signs of impending rupture. Be prepared with a Trendelenburg position. Be prepared with a uterine relaxant anesthesia if required. Pre-plan the uterine incision. Now, if you decided to go for a vaginal disimpaction, a manual disimpaction, or using a vectus or the forceps, take a lower incision. Make the incision adequate. Make the incision curvilinear because you are otherwise going to have a tear going down vertically in the lower segment. But if you're planning a Patwardhan's maneuver, do a higher incision at the level of the fetal shoulders. Now, in this particular case, again, we've got another vectus delivery. If it's a deeply engaged head, we go in, you make your incision, you do a manual disimpaction from above. You can usually insinuate fingers between the head and the pubic symphysis. It's painful, your fingers will cramp, but when you're successful, slip one branch below the head, and then use it as a vectus as your anesthetist or an assistant gives fundal pressure and you can ease the head out. But this is a maneuver that I'd hardly ever used till very recently. It was an elderly patient. She was a doctor's wife. We were trying for a normal delivery and at full dilatation, she just wouldn't deliver. And you can see how deeply engaged that head is. And my hand just can't get below it. You can almost see my hand kind of shaking and cramping. And that's when I decided to do a Patwardhan's maneuver. Now, to do a Patwardhan's maneuver, the first thing, you've got two ways of doing it. You've got the classical way where you go for the shoulders. My space was inadequate. So you immediately go and create more space for yourself. I am very partial to also doing the Sherney's incision whenever required. So now you've got one arm of the baby out and then you go for the other hand. And there are the shoulders. And this is very much like a swimmer doing a butterfly stroke. After that, you go for the pelvis. In this case, I wasn't able to get to it. So I got a leg out, held it with a mop. And once you bring that baby's pelvis out, I myself was amazed. And that's what Dr. Patwardhan probably must be given so much credit for. The head just slipped out and all was well. We then come to malpresentations. And, you know, delivering a breech was probably a work of art. And John Ruskin said, with love and while love and skill work together, expect a masterpiece. When you have a breech delivery at C-section, trust me, you need every maneuver, you need every skill that you would have to have at vaginal breech. In fact, at C-section, you are actually doing a breech extraction, not an assisted breech delivery. So the abdominal delivery is no different. Limbs have to be manipulated through their natural range of movement. The trunk needs to be supported by the pelvic girdle, not by the abdomen, and deliver the aftercoming head with the Morris or Smelly Weight maneuver, or my personal belief, the best delivery for an aftercoming head, vaginal or C-section, is using a forceps. So you can see how gently you hold the fetus. You sweep the knee back in its natural position. You're holding the baby by the pelvis. You sweep out the limbs from behind the shoulder again in their natural position. Free a loop of cord, because by now very often the cord is being pressed and compressed. Have a sheet or a mop to kind, that's you freeing the cord. Lift up the baby the way a stork would carry a baby. And then go in with your forceps. Trust me, this is extremely easy and simple to do. And the advantage of having a forceps applied on the head is when you flex that head, you're not applying any kind of pressure on the cervical spine, and you can take your time and deliver the baby with the forceps in an aftercoming head. Otherwise, it tends to be a little difficult, particularly with the smaller incisions. Multiple pregnancies are always a challenge. Difficulties are things that show a person what they are. Multiple pregnancies have a very large single or two placentae, which take a lot of space. The lie and relationships are all confused. You start off with planning a delivery of the presenting fetus, whatever it is. Orientation may be disoriented, and that's distorted, and that's why you need to know your landmarks on the fetus. And very often, because of all the space, you may have asyncletism. And of course, you double clamp the cord of the first fetus so as to protect the second. So this is a twin delivery. In this twin delivery, we have the first fetus. In this case, it was a breech delivery. You make again an adequate incision. So very often when I'm expecting difficulty, I do a Sherney's incision. I do it very easily. You detach the rectus muscles from their attachment and you suddenly find the space opens up, and the recovery once you've stitched these muscles back is very simple. So in this particular case, again, you're accessing, you're going in gradually. And once you've done that, I usually prefer to incise, but then I also use the scissor at the edges to control the incision. And then finally, of course, use my fingers to stretch as well. This gives me the best incision. And then of course, I feel that I can suture it much better. Once this is done, you first decide which fetus you're going in for. And here you have, you can see one amniotic cavity. You can see the sac still intact. And now here I felt the head on one side. It's very, very much towards one side. You can see my forceps is going for a proper cephalic application. In this case, it may not be the way I normally apply it. And once you've kind of brought that head and you've kind of held that head, you can guide it out. Usually this kind of the positions are a little disoriented, And you can see here that though normally I try to do a lateral lift out position, in this particular case, the forceps is not in a lateral lift out. The sagittal suture is vertical and it was an occipital posterior position. What about difficult abdominal and uterine access? Here you probably need to take your time, because to strive with difficulties and conquer them is the highest human felicity. Abdominal incision, be prepared for a vertical incision when you are doing an emergent access. Fan and seal incision, do not hesitate to muscle cut if required. Take your time to do an adequate excision of the previous surgical scar, because this will tend to be very rigid and tend to interfere with your delivery. If in doubt, well, nowadays I've stopped opening the UV fold, but whenever in doubt, I will dissect the bladder peritoneum down, because if you adequately deflect it down, you protect the bladder. You do a sharp dissection, no blunt pushing down with mops and gauze pieces, and use a curvilinear or a U-shaped incision. So what happens is you maximize available space, and if there is an extension, it protects the uterine vessels. Without hesitation, an inverted T-shape and an occasional vertical incision if you are struggling. So this is a patient who had previous 3 cesareans. This was her 4th. And you can see here that we did find that things were, anatomy wasn't that clear. So I had opened the UV fold, and that what I'm holding up is where the bladder was at. I could easily make an incision above that, but when it came to suturing, it might have been a bit of a challenge. So here you can so clearly see your plane of cleavage. And once you've got your plane of cleavage right and move the bladder down a little bit, you can make your incision and then complete your C-section. Something we are seeing more and more often today, maternal obesity. And this is something that all of us are dealing with. This mother was between 110 and 120 kilos. She was a doctor. Thankfully, I decided to do a C-section, and I'll tell you why pretty soon. Fan and steel incision, usually in the fold. Sometimes the fold may be very, very contaminated with infection. Then don't go in the fold. Go above. Avoid the fold. Otherwise, healing is going to be affected. I wouldn't have dreamt of delivering this baby any other way. Thankfully, I do use a forceps routinely. You can see we don't waste even a millimeter of space when it comes to the baby. And believe me, this was the only way we could have delivered this 5.2 kilo baby in a mother who was not a diabetic, but just an obese mother herself. Prematurity is something we are dealing with more and more. And with the premature fetus, you have difficulties, because you now have a very poorly formed lower segment, sometimes almost no lower segment, more malpresentations, a real delicate fetus. I mean, we've done sections for babies at 25 and 26 weeks. You could have associated problems, anomalies, fibroids, adenomyosis. What do you hear? First, localize the placenta. Be prepared with the presentation. Try and make an adequate uterine incision. And in this particular case, I have a new tool at my disposal, and that is a pair of forceps that Dr. Piley has devised. I think each and every one of us should get this set of forceps. These are small forceps that I've used for the 24, 25, 26 weekers. This is the slightly larger forceps for a baby of around 32 weeks. A traditional forceps won't work because that baby's head is just too small for the cephalic curve. This is Dr. Piley's instrument. Fan and steel incision. You can see here that I try not to waste an incision, and the incision is tailor-made or custom-made for that particular baby. And I believe by doing this, I also get better healing because I save space. So that was Dr. Piley's incision, doing a cage forceps for a premature baby, which you then very gently deliver. Now, sometimes a myoma gets in the way. I do not believe in rushing in for myomectomies at C-section. But in a case like this, where I had to have a myoma in the way of my incision, I made my incision just below the myoma, and then I was not going to leave the myoma there. So this is something that we need to be prepared with. Your principles of myomectomy remain. In this case, usually I will only go after them if they are in my incision. So I use the incision to access the myoma, so I don't have another scar on the uterus. And then you very gently dissect out the myoma from its capsule during pregnancy. Sometimes it doesn't peel off as easily as it would when it's, but you're continuously achieving hemostasis. And once you've kind of done your excision from that, capsule, you can see here, I'm kind of opening the capsule there as well. Suturing to close off the capsule. That's the rest of the myoma coming out. And then I actually close that space. And when I suture my lower segment, that takes care of the incision of the myoma. And this is the one time, particularly when we have myoma sitting right there on the lower uterine segment and you can't get through it. And you can see how, take the major blood vessels, because these might have large feeders, close the space, close the incision. I think for want of time, I'm going to move on. And I'm going to come to the last case. And this is an out-of-the-box procedure. Jawaharlal Nehru said, the policy of being too cautious is the greatest risk of all. This was a case of endometriosis, who conceived. I didn't expect her to, severe endometriosis. And when you went in, you felt things weren't quite right. And I was trying to dissect out the space and get to the peritoneum. And in this particular case, you know, you were kind of wondering what you're doing. And my Foley's catheter was actually low down. And when I opened the peritoneum, I realized I'd opened the bladder. In this particular case, when we finally tried to trace the bladder by putting a finger in it, the bladder reached all the way up to the fundus. This was a gravid uterus with a bladder stuck right from the top of the uterus all the way there. In this case, I actually had to take an inverted T incision. You can see there, not on the uterus, but on the abdominal wall. So you have to think on your feet. With a finger in the bladder, I was able to dissect the bladder down, deliver the baby, close the bladder. The patient is fine. The child is now pretty grown up. The only thing we decided was that we wouldn't do this again. Finally, please be prepared for any situation, because by failing to prepare, you're preparing to fail. And one of the ways of preparing is by having a specific consent for C-sections. Okay. Gone are the vanilla consents. They won't stand up in a court of law. So this consent that we use in our hospital talks about the indication, the proposed procedure, says what a C-section is, talks about all the general risks of surgery, talks about hemorrhage, shock, injury, extension of incision, rupture, fetal injury, and then finally signs off with the patient saying, I understand that there might be unforeseen circumstances, that you might have another doctor coming in, and that the patient accepts that medicine is not an exact science. And I think we need to do more and more of this for different procedures. I finally end with three quotations. In difficult cesarean sections, let's remember Hippocrates, who said, primum non nocere, first do no harm. Be prepared. For me, the obstetric forceps has been a game changer. I have a lot of people I know who've started using this almost routinely now. Use it in a low-risk case so you're prepared for the high-risk complicated situations when its use will be indispensable. When things get tough, and trust me, sometimes things will get tough, and they will always get tough for each and every one of us once in a while. Winston Churchill said, if you're going through hell, keep going. Don't stop. Don't freeze. You have the experience. You have the knowledge. You have the judgment. Just keep calm. Call for help. But believe me, most times you'll just do it yourself. And finally, Napoleon Hill has said, do not despair, because patience, persistence, and perspiration make an unbeatable combination for success. I mean, Napoleon Hill could be talking about all obstetricians, because that's what we have. We are patient, we persist, and our patience to make us perspire. But the end of it, the outcome is so, so pleasurable and satisfactory that, you know what, I believe we just do obstetrics for the love of it. Thank you very much. It's been a privilege.
Thank you so much, Noza sir. I think all of us are spellbound with respect to one, thinking that all these complications can actually happen during the cesarean. And, you know, two, yes, of course,
knowing that we are much more prepared to handle them right now. It was an excellent lecture. Jaideep, so we have a couple of questions. Can we take the questions and can we skip the promo video towards the end of the session?
No, what we'll do is, Apurva, that we'll take the questions. I know I can see there are a couple of them. They are mostly complimentary comments for Noza's lecture.
Yes, Dr. Alekia from Hyderabad has joined. Thank you so much. I think Dr. Nitya has a question from Arod has a question for you, Jaideep, sir. That can be, she's, I think, requested you to put the oxytocin chart for labor room.
Okay, sure, I'll do that, but I'll do it after the panel discussion so Dr. Nitya stays till the end.
Awesome. That's and I think, Noza, sir, for you, Dr. Uma, Dr. Uma has sent her, appreciation all the way from Chennai, and she's told that she's remembering her times in Wadia Hospital per se. And Dr. Shobha from Kolhapur has a question that do you use both the blades for delivery of the head in breech when you're doing during the section?
Always. For breech, you have to use both the blades. Okay. Because just think of the forceps as a cage. I know we use cage forceps as a term for the premature baby. And people will say, I'm just saying it, but it's really extremely simple. You just have to maneuver that mentum to a posterior position, slip in the left blade, though I often use the Hayes forceps. So which blade you use doesn't really matter. I often use the blade on the right-hand side first. And ask an assistant to hold the blade in place. If it's a cross blade, goes from the other side. I usually use both blades of the forceps. The other thing I do in most cases is when I first saw the forceps being applied, it was Dr. V.N. Purandare, and they were actually manipulating the sagittal suture to the AP diameter. And I said, but that's not what we do at a normal C-section. So for me, I always want the sagittal suture to be transverse. I apply the forceps. The forceps allows me to do two things, traction and flexion. Don't forget the suboccipitobrigmatic diameter is the smallest diameter when the baby is coming out through the pelvis, but also when the baby is coming out at C-section. And when you flex the head and you've held the head well, you always manage to do this with the smallest possible fan and seal incision. I'm not saying that fan and seal incisions have to be very small, but believe me, for every 1 centimeter less, your patient's going to have less post-op pain and is going to recover sooner. And of course, she's going to love you because she's going to see your incision every day and she's going to appreciate the fact that it looks so great.
Thank you, sir. Jaideep, sir, I think we have one more question for you from Dr. Shubhangi from Indore. She's asked the role of vinoprostol in labor induction.
So there are two separate things. There's induction and then there is augmentation. And to tell you the truth, I don't use misoprostol in term pregnancies which are wanted. If there is an IUFD, I wouldn't mind priming the cervix a little with either mifepristone or misoprostol. But routinely speaking, I don't use misoprostol at all. Having said that, there is some evidence to show that if you use 20 or 25 micrograms of misoprostol, it can work quite efficiently. But personally speaking, I think misoprostol is such an efficacious and wonderful drug. And I do get a little scared of its efficacy in term pregnancies. I know I have some friends who always think that I'm a little, darpok for not using misoprostol in term pregnancies. But still, I like oxytocin because I think it gives me a little more control. And now with the use of infusion pumps, I think the way you can use oxytocin and the versatility that the infusion pump brings to the dosing of oxytocin for titrating the uterine activity is really quite remarkable. So I don't really see misoprostol becoming the norm for the use either in induction or augmentation of labor at term in a wanted pregnancy. In an IUFD, that is a completely different story. And if I may say so, a story for another episode of the O2S Masterclass.
Sure. Doctor, I think last question, this is more of a statement. I think Dr. Chitra from Rajapalliam, she has asked medical management of PCOS. Should we ask ma'am to just wait for our next series of webinars, sir?
Yes. I'm happy to announce that once we are through with the O2S series, which gets over on, I think, the 14th of April, we are proceeding with a G2Y series where we'll have a mix of infertility and gynecology topics that we will be speaking on for the next maybe 4 or 5 months. So we will certainly be looking at PCOS in that.
Definitely, sir. Thank you so much. Sir, shall we quickly start the panel discussion?
No, Purva, do the video and then we'll do the panel.
Sure. As I think Jaideep sir and all of us also know very well that it wouldn't have been possible for us to conduct these 20 webinar series without the support of our pharma team. So may I request Team Torrent to play their video, please.
The triangle of B-complex is essential for pregnant women in their dietary process, as while conceiving, women find it difficult to produce adequate levels of vitamins. With external supplements, they get their required dosage, which is ready for absorption and utility by the body. Vitamin D also is most crucial in pregnancy and lactation. For prevention from adverse outcomes, future risk to health of child, and maternal and fetal health during pregnancy. European Society for Pediatric Endocrinology confirms vitamin D3, 2000 IU per day, ensures adequate vitamin D status in pregnancy and early infancy. Vitamin D3 supplementation helps achieve the sufficiency and can be taken for a long duration. Calcium also plays an important role in pregnancy as its twofold requirement increases. Adequate maternal health is needed for fetal bone health, and as per the BMC Public Health article, calcium supplementation during pregnancy reduces gestational hypertension by 45% and preeclampsia by 59%. Effective management of pregnancy demands supplementation of prenatal vitamins. This supplementation provides protection against various defects that can occur during pregnancy. Shellcal XT provides protection against neural tube defects. It reduces the risk of preterm birth and congenital heart diseases. Shellcal XT contains 1250 mg of calcium carbonate, which is required to maintain maternal skeletal calcium. 2000 IU of vitamin D ensures adequate status in pregnancy and early infancy. Shellcal XT has 1000 micrograms of L-methylfolate. Journal of Clinical Pharmacology and New Drugs confirms that L-methylfolate helps in decreasing the risk of NTD by 72%. The methylcobalamin at 1,500 micrograms improves pregnancy outcome and maintains normal folate metabolism. The additional pyridoxal 5-phosphate at 20 mg reduces nausea and vomiting in pregnant women. From preconception, pregnancy to lactation, Shellcal XT is a world-class product for vitamin supplementation. Shellcal XT has special coating technology and vitamin D3 in stabilized form. Shellcal XT helps to reduce the pill burden. Dosage of Shellcal XT is one tablet once a day. Each ingredient in Shellcal XT is coated separately, so there is no drug-to-drug interaction. Shellcal XT scored tablet gives dosage convenience. A healthy start leads to healthy mothers, and healthy mothers make a healthy generation. After all, every pregnancy is precious.
Thank you. thank you so much, Team Torrent, for their unconditional extended support for all these webinars. Now may I request the most awaited session for the week, that is our discussion on antibiotics prescribing in pregnancy, what is the teratogenicity effect, and everything else that kind of follows with respect to fetal toxicity. Whenever we think of an obstetric webinars or series, I think it is not possible for us to not think of Palniappan, sir. He is so passionate about obstetrics and managing pregnancies and women care that it shows in every talk and every lecture that he gives. He's been the past chairperson of Safe Motherhood Committee as well, and he's done brilliant work in these front. May I request Dr. Palni sir to take over the session and introduce all his panelists. I think the panelists can introduce themselves. We have a really eminent group of panelists who have joined with us today. I'm really looking forward to all the inputs that they are going to give. All over to you, Professor.
Good evening, Dr. Jaydeep. Good evening, Dr. Noza. And I'm extremely, you're able to hear me, Purva?
Absolutely, sir. Yes, sir.
See my slide as well?
Yes, sir. Fine. And we can see the baby crying also, sir.
Okay, fine. Yeah. Thank you very much. And it is indeed a pleasure to be a part of this O2S series. And I'm extremely happy to be here this evening amongst a very elite group of panelists, and but I'm a little jittery also for the very simple reason that I'm speaking after Dr. Kurian, Dr. Jaydeep, and Dr. Noza. So, and you know, it's like a sandwich, which Dr. Kurian said some time back, O to S. And so I'm the person in between the three before and the seven of them here. And so they're such an elite panel I've got, and so I've got to go. But then Noza did say that in despair, if you're going through hell, go through it and you will do well. And I take Dr. Noza's words and go through this. And I'm sure it's going to be heaven at the end of the panel. And welcome to this panel on drugs in pregnancy, maybe antibiotics, maybe drugs, and maybe teratogenicity and fetal toxicity. So that's what we have made. I've not made antibiotics alone. So, and trust me, the panelists here do not know what questions are we going to be asked. And so they are absolutely virgin as far as the questions are concerned. And so coming to the panelists, we have Dr. Renu Makwana, Dr. Leela Vyas, Dr. Preeti Jindal. I hope Dr. Preeti has logged in. I couldn't see her before. Dr. Pranjal Sharma, Dr. Prema Shinde, Dr. Panda. I couldn't see him. Dr. Neeraj. Yes, I did see him. So welcome to this panel. And I'm sure the panelists are very, very well known to the entire group of Indian obstetricians. And here we go on to the panel. I've got three case discussions and a couple of slides in between each case discussion. So we will have definitely 45 minutes to go through that. Pregnancy risk is of major congenital anomalies, 2-3%, and risk to 7-10% if it's a minor anomaly is included, like a cleft palate, etc. And please understand that the drug exposure is 2-3% of all the birth defects. So it's only 2-3% of what we could produce using drugs. And so that's what we're going to talk to about this particular panel. And we need to also understand that placental transfer of drugs, most drugs cross the placental barrier by simple diffusion and not by facilitated diffusion or active transport, if you remember these terms in your 11th and 12th standards. And the factors responsible for these transfer are, can I ask Dr. Prerna to answer this question? What do you think are the factors which would be responsible for the placental transfer which is going to happen? Or Dr. Renu Makwana, I can see her login first. Dr. Renu. Hello?
Yeah, hello. Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, Dr. Renu. Yeah, yeah, you're audible.
Yeah, okay. Most drugs cross the placental barrier by simple diffusion. There are certain factors that they are soluble or some lipid, their molecular weight, concentration of the drug, free drugs, lipid solubility, and due to placental blood flow. So they are, these are dependent on these factors.
Perfect. And although also we should think in terms of uteroplasmic blood flow. Very nice, Dr. Renu. And we move on. And you need to also know that what do you think is the acute teratogenic period of pregnancy that we are bothered about, and I'm sure Dr. Sharma will be able to say that because she's been asking questions and making me prepare what she wanted. And Dr. Sharma, we've just added whatever you wanted as well. And what do you think is the acute teratogenic period in pregnancy which we are bothered about, and during which part of the gestation age are we worried about for teratogenicity? Dr. Sharma?
Hello?
Yes,
yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes, yes, very clear.
Yeah, yeah. So, see, we are very much concerned about the teratogenicity period. And roughly, if it is taken, a rough passage is that first trimester full is a teratogenic period. But we can still divide it into three parts. Like we can say before day 31.
Okay.
Before day 31, there goes the all and none law. If the drug has affected the embryo, that embryo either will survive or will not survive. So this is all and none law. If the embryo survives, then the studies has proven that there is no absolutely any teratogenic effect on that before, if it is given before day 31. Now, from day 31 to day 71, this is the most vulnerable period where the embryogenesis, the most of the part of the embryogenesis is occurring. And this is the critical period when the defect in the embryo or some teratogenicity can cause. And after day 71, there are like developmental or IUGR kind of effects are there. So these are the three periods, but roughly we can take that the first trimester full can be a period of the vulnerability for the teratogenicity.
Perfect. You just wanted what I said, and that's what is there in the diagram. And so after that, it is internal organ development and growth. But then as far as you're concerned, it's only between day 31 and 71, which is exactly
71.
Yes. Teratogenic period, classic period of gestation. That's what we are absolutely worried about. And after that, it's not that we're not worried. We are worried, but then not much because. And now Dr. Neeraj, the sexual medicine person to say, what do you think is the category of FDA, ABCD something? Dr. Neeraj, would you want to tell me about what do these categories mean? Category A, B, C, whatever.
Category A is their safe drugs. Means in category A, there is an adequate human trial that suggests there is no adverse effect on the patient. Where in B, there is an animal study either showing adverse effect or showing that there is no adverse effect, but there is a not adequate human trial on human. That is category B drug. In category C drug, there is some risk is there, where in animal studies, it's showing that there is a teratogenicity, but there is no enough human study. While category D is there is a risk in some study, it's suggesting that there is an adverse effect on the fetus in human trial. While category X is totally contraindicated, it shows that there is so many teratogenic effects if you use the category X drug.
Thank you, Neeraj. And so here we go on to the case one, and we would take 10 minutes of each case so that we will be able to finish. And is Dr. Preeti Jindal logged in? I'm not able to see her. Dr. Preeti, are you there? Dr. Panda as well is not there. Dr. Leela Vyas, madam, are you there, ma'am? Leela Vyas?
I'm coming. I was in labor room. I'm coming out of labor room. I'll just join within 5 minutes.
Okay,
within
ma'am.
2-3 minutes, I'll join you. Yeah.
Fine, ma'am. Okay, fine. So I'm sure Dr. Prerna did join. Prerna Shinde.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, you're there. Known epileptic who's not on treatment, and we don't know what treatment she's on. Primary gravida, 26 weeks gestation. She's normotensive. Her BP has been absolutely normal, comes with convulsions. And so now, Dr. Prerna, you tell me, what do you think will be the choice of anti-epileptic? She's a known epileptic. So let's not go into magnesium sulfate and talk about it and create a scene there. So what do you think is the anti-epileptic drug of choice which you would give for this particular lady who's 26 weeks gestation and a known epileptic? Dr. Prerna? Hello? Yeah, Dr. Prerna. Dr. Prerna is not there. Dr. Renu, do you want to take the question?
No, no, Dr. Prerna is there, but she has muted herself. So if
Dr. Prerna, I'm just not able to get her into the...
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you now.
Yeah. Yeah, phenytoin sodium would be my drug of choice in case of
perfect. Okay, so if so, what do you think is the dosage you would use, and what do you think would be the caution you would use phenytoin sodium?
Phenytoin sodium around doses. This dose is when the patient is having convulsions.
Perfect.
We will give a bolus dose and one ampoule every 4 hours for first 24 hours once she settles down, and then gradually we will taper off the dose.
The reason why we have to go slow and about the dosage, why we are asking about the dosage is that it will matter, because the dosage of phenytoin sodium matters because it is dose dependent. I'm sure the dosage will, if you give more, will produce side effects like cardiac arrhythmias, nystagmus, and giddiness. So we need to be bothered about the dose. That's exactly why we put this on this particular panel. And Dr. Pray, now continuing with that, so what do you think would be the worries of this particular drug if you had given it earlier during the first trimester of the typical 31 to 71 days which we talked about? So are we worried about something called as phenytoin syndrome, whatever? So what do you think, what is your worry about the phenytoin?
The possibility of congenital anomalies like cleft lip, cleft palate, if the drug is given between the period of 31 to 71 days.
And this is the phenytoin syndrome. I'm sure you're able to see my slide, isn't it, Dr. Prem? Yeah?
Cleft palate, that is all on this thing.
Fine, yeah. So, and we have a typical phenytoin syndrome with hypertelorism, epicanthal folds, growth deficiency, and of course limb defects with hyperplasia of the digital phalanges and the nail. And so we need to be bothered about this, which can very well be picked up by an ultrasound on the anomaly scan. And so we need to be very worried about this. We had given it earlier, but she's, anyway, she's 26 weeks now. And what do you think is the class of drug of phenytoin sodium? What do you think is the FDA class drug? And do we give anything else along with the drug, if at all you're giving, to prevent any of the drug? And do you have any other alternative drug which you can give instead of phenytoin sodium? If we don't think in terms of magnesium sulfate, can we give anything else? Dr. Panda, are you there from Berhampur? Dr. Panda?
Dano.
Hello. Okay, fine. Dr. Sharma can take the question. Dr. Sharma, would you want to take the question and say, what do you think is phenytoin class of drug, and is there anything else you would give along with phenytoin when a patient is an antiepileptic, and any other alternative drug you could think in terms of apart from phenytoin?
In class FDA, I think it goes in the class D. And prophylactic drugs we can go for is a safer, like along with that, when any anti-epilepsy drugs, they compete with for the folic acid. So we are supposed to add adequate B-complex folic acid vitamin K. And new alternative drug can be levacetam or carbamazepine we were using, but levacetam has got a promising this thing nowadays.
Perfect, Dr. Sharma. What I just wanted, you just told, women with epilepsy or anti convulsants have 2 to 3 times increased risk of anomalies by themselves. Just by being an epileptic, they have that increased risk. And the sodium valproic acid and carbamazepine, 1% increase for neural tube defects. Phenytoin, 10% more of offsprings of fetal hydantoin syndrome.
True.
Need to keep in mind. And we have 2 drugs to think in terms of. One is the lamotrigine and another is the levetiracetam. Lamotrigine inhibitor of the dihydrofolate reductase, which decreases the embryonic folate levels. And you need to think in terms of some preventive measure, give a monotherapy and folic acid vitamin K supplementation. And coming to the levetiracetam, do we have evidence now? Yes, we have enough evidence here. This, I've quoted the Indian Journal of Pharmacology here. All over the world, we have evidence to say, yes, you can use levetiracetam during pregnancy in women with epilepsy. And
safely.
No questions of teratogenicity of using the levetiracetam. So you could go ahead, and let's not go into the dosage of levetiracetam. And we would go on to the case 2. Dr. Neeraj, a well-educated 28-year-old, second gravida, previous normal delivery, 5 weeks and 4 days with mitral valve replacement a year back. And she's on tablet warfarin 1 OD. She seeks advice regarding continuation of warfarin sodium, safety of warfarin, risks involved, and at present she's very well compensated. She's class Niha 1, Carpeg, no risk. And what do you think is a drug which you would think continue warfarin? Would you want to change to some other drug? And what are your thoughts on this particular lady, Dr. Neeraj?
What dose warfarin is going on? Because dose is
on the very basic drug of warfarin, a very small dose. She's just telling one tablet.
Okay.
What she's able to say. Let's assume 2 points. Would you want to say that? Would you continue warfarin if it's a small dosage of drug in the first trimester? She's only 5 weeks of pregnancy. 6 weeks, 5 weeks and 4 days. Yeah.
No.
Hello.
Yes, Neeraj, you're able to hear.
Yeah. Low molecular weight heparin is the preferred in such cases.
Why do you want low molecular weight heparin, Neeraj? Why can't you go in and change classical heparin, and why can't you continue warfarin?
Because warfarin is associated with the anomalies like neurotic mutate, cardiac anomalies.
Okay.
So, yeah. That's why we have to change it to the low molecular weight heparin.
Fine.
And it is a warfarin is a class B drug, while low molecular weight heparin is a class B.
Perfect. Fine. Okay. So we are worried about warfarin embryopathy, which would have these symptoms, and so we don't want embryopathy, and so probably we'll think in terms of starting heparin at this point of time. She's only around 6 weeks, and so we would probably change to heparin. And Neeraj, you want to say, why do you want to start low molecular weight heparin rather than classical unfractionated heparin?
Because to titrate the dose of the heparin is sometimes difficult, and to use the low molecular weight heparin is the better option.
There is high risk of thromboembolism with the fractionated heparin, so which pregnancy is already a hypercoagulable state, so we don't want to take any more risk. So that is what low molecular weight heparin is preferred.
Good. Very nice. So those are the reasons why you would not do. And I'm sure Dr. Leela B.S. has just joined in. Leela ma'am, would you want to do any investigations before starting any heparin for that matter, whether it's low molecular weight or classical unfractionated heparin? Would you want to start any investigations before doing a trial on the heparin dosage?
For unfractionated heparin, we should go for platelet counts. And for LMWS, no investigation is needed usually.
Fine.
And routine blood test and platelet count are required for unfractionated heparin.
Perfect. Fine.
Every so time.
What do you think? Yeah. And what do you think your maintenance should be? Hello?
You would like to go for the PT, APTT is one of the choice of that investigation.
Fine.
Especially in heparin. Are you getting my voice?
Yes, I'm getting a point. But anyway, we're not going to use water. That's just for reference out here.
Just give me time. Actually, network is not working.
Okay, ma'am. Okay. No problem. Yeah. Fine. Okay. So if that's what we're going to do, the INR, and then do an APTT and monitor the APTT, and monitoring is a big hindrance while you're using unfractured heparin. Otherwise, it's easily available and cheap. And that's where it is. And Dr. Sharma, would you want to say, when do you stop heparin when the patient is going to be in labor, induction, in cesarean section or whatever? When do you want to stop it and when do you want to start it?
If the patient goes in labor, then like if she goes in labor beforehand, then we don't have any choice. As soon as she goes in labor, we are supposed to stop and get her INR done immediately. And it should be in between 2 to 2.5 or max to max 3. That should be the point. And if we are planning her induction or so, or we are going for cesarean section, 6 hours before delivery, we can stop. And before normal delivery, and 1 day prior or 24 hours before the cesarean section, we can stop. And 2 days after the delivery, if she's on low dose heparin, we again will do her INR to know her status of coagulation in her body. And in case of warfarin, 5 to 7 days after postpartum, we can.
Fine. Okay. Dr. Preeti, have you logged in, Dr. Preeti Jindal? Apurva, is Dr. Preeti not able to join us, Apurva? Fine. Okay. Fine. So now when you do on this, we also need to keep in mind that we have fresh frozen plasma kept in mind and vitamin A, 5 milligrams subcutaneous to the newborn, 1 milligram IM. And when you think in terms of heparin, stop the dosage if you have a complication. And then we'll have to think in terms of the antidote protamine sulfate, 1 milligram. And if it is IV, twice the dosage, and think in terms of the fresh frozen plasma always. Yeah. And Dr. Panda, are you there? Have you joined us? Okay, we are missing Dr. Panda. Dr. Renu, going on to Dr. Renu, what do you think can be the problems with heparin, and why do we think, apart from dosing and difficulty in managing the INR and monitoring, any other problems with heparin do you think? Dr. Renu Makwana.
Yeah, there is problem with the platelet count, and in long term it causes osteoporosis in the patients also, and monitoring is again important for the frequent injections are needed. And at times we can see bruises at the site of injection, and high doses, they may cause cerebral hemorrhage, abruption, osteoporosis there. And there is autoimmune thrombocytopenia with that. And at times allergic reactions are also there with unfractionated heparin, which is not there with low molecular heparin.
Apart from daily using, daily dosing and monitoring, we have other long-term complications like this as well. And so we need to be really bothered about giving the classical heparin, which I'm sure all of us were when we were postgraduates or undergraduates. But then what do you think is the category of heparin which we are using? And do you think it's secreted in breast milk? And are we going to be bothered about the fetal effects of the heparin? Dr. Neeraj?
Yes. No, I think category C drug heparin is the.
And warfarin is secreted, whereas heparin is not secreted because of its huge molecular weight. And so we don't have to be worried when we give breast milk and lactation. We're not really bothered. And heparin is a category B drug of FDA. And so probably we can go ahead and give heparin without any difficulty. But then now coming to the question of, can LMH, AWH, low molecular weight heparin, may it be enoxaparin, fraxiparin, whatever, can be used is the next question. And Dr. Prerna, what is your choice on the low molecular weight heparin? How do you want to monitor a lady who's on low molecular weight heparin? Because having spoken of the difficulties of heparin, which is still widely used in a lot of government hospitals, what do you think is the idea of using LMWH, can we use, and how do you want to monitor this patient?
I think it's basically heparin, it's with low molecular weight heparin, things are easier than using fractionated heparin or warfarin. And you just have to keep a watch on bleeding time, clotting time, and this thing. And it's we've been using it so regularly. I think, and we can plan labor well in advance. At till 34 weeks, we can continue with the low molecular weight heparin, and after that, we can stop the drug, and we can go ahead further. That's this thing.
We're not talking of aplamotin where we are using. Yeah, so I think we will use heparin just before delivery because we are using it for a heart disease patient. So we will use it 6 hours before delivery. One day before, right? And then
APTT should be monitored.
Fine. Okay. So, and can, how do we use? Yes, and women on lifelong anticoagulation, like this particular lady, yes, they should have preconception counseling, and they maybe switch to LMWH for the preconceptual period, or changed from warfarin to LMWH after the diagnosis of pregnancy, like this particular case, within 6 weeks of conception. And this is the algorithm, may I say, for the women with mechanical heart valves. And so at around that particular time, you will change to LMWH, and therapeutic dose of low molecular weight heparin, BD dosing with peak anti-10A levels, adjusted as per the manufacturer's guidelines, or warfarin from 12 to 13 weeks. There is a recommendation to change to warfarin at 13 weeks after the first trimester. But then if you're comfortable with the LMWH, please go ahead and switch to LMWH at 34 to 36 weeks if on warfarin. And you would switch to intravenous unfractionated heparin infusion before planned induction or cesarean section, for the very, very simple reason that we don't have an antidote for low molecular weight heparin, whereas for heparin, we have protamine sulfate and we'll be able to control it better. So during delivery, probably we'll think in terms of giving heparin, and then therapeutic low molecular weight heparin dosage should not be recommended until 24 hours after delivery. So during delivery, I'm sure you will manage with unfractionated heparin and then change over to low molecular weight heparin or maybe even warfarin. And while that time, do an overlap of low molecular weight heparin or heparin with warfarin, maintaining the INR between 2 and
2.5.
Dr. Sharma, now it's your chance to answer, because I'm sure this is a question which you would want to. What do you think is the, I've not put a case here, we finished the second case. What do you think is the antibiotics which you think you can prescribe in pregnancy and antibiotics which you can't prescribe in pregnancy? Dr. Sharma.
Yeah. There are some, what you say, the gold points about the antibiotics in pregnancy. We should maintain all these, that use medication or antibiotics only if absolutely indicated, number one. Number two, if possible, try using this in the first trimester. Number three, as far as possible, go for the safer option. There are certain drugs which are safe in pregnancy with proven records, with proven experience and data. So we should go for the safer drug. Whenever possible, go for the single drug therapy than with the polypharmacy or multiple drugs in pregnancy. Use the lowest, safest dose in pregnancy and stop as early as possible. We can stop it. Discourage over-the-counter drug for pregnancy. So these are the thing in pregnancy, as we all know, that we have to understand the pregnancy, that there are certain things which do not need medication at all in pregnancy in the form of antibiotic. If you remember long back in when we were students, we were said by our professors that upper respiratory tract infection takes 7 days with medication and without medication a week. So sometimes some things they do not need at all the antibiotics. So in that cases, just learn about the disease. Just small crocins or paracetamol to decrease the fever and
point
symptomatic treatment.
Very well taken, Dr. Sharma. What do you think is the antibiotic which we can use, and what do you think is the antibiotic which we cannot use in pregnancy?
See, since long, what we have been seeing is the gold standard till date is the penicillin. But to tell you the fact that penicillin, I have not seen in my practice in last 10 years, penicillin been used rampantly. Cephalosporin is another group of drug which is very, very safe in pregnancy. Along with that, if we are concerned about the beta-lactamase stability, clavulanic acid can be added. It is very safe in pregnancy. Yes, erythromycin in second trimester, nitrofurantoins with caution and whenever needed, metronidazole can be used. But the drugs which are safe should not be used are the tetracycline, sulfonamides, because as we all know that tetracycline can cause the discoloration of the teeth, bone defects, etc. can cause, and there is a red flag also for the aminoglycosides. It can, like previously we used to use the gentamicin, now amino. So ototoxicity is very much known in fetus with this drug. So antibiotics, when and wherever needed, with all these due precaution and gold standard points, we should be concerned about it.
You mentioned nitrofurantoin, but I think it is associated with the IUGR, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes, with care, with care.
One thing
it was written that it is safe.
But in the, that as the nitrofurantoin, Dr. Sharma, you have said that we can avoid the antibiotics, but the problem of urinary tract infection.
Yes, yes, ma'am.
There we always need and it is required for the long duration.
Yeah, but yes, nitrofurantoin, we can also go with the cephalosporins in lower doses for longer period, like cephalosporins, cephalaxin 250 milligram for 10 days or 15 days. It takes, like it is a broad spectrum coverage will be there. And if it is not treated with that, with care, we can go with the nitrofurantoins.
Dr. Sharma, understand Dr. Leela V.S.'s concern that we need to give for a UTI and we can have recurrent UTIs in pregnancy, nitrofurantoin.
Yes.
That's what Leela
It should be given. Yes, yes, yes. It should be given. That's what I said, that it should be given. And the urinary tract infection is the most concerned thing in the pregnancy. It must be treated, because if it is not treated, it will lead to the long-term complication like pyelonephritis. It will lead to many other complications. So it should be used.
So having spoken about UTI...
Cephalosporin is there, so why should you... Why you can't use cephalosporin?
We can give cephalosporin.
We can give cephalosporin.
Yeah, Dr. Neeraj, if she's sensitive to nitrofurantoin, it is easier to use nitrofurantoin also. That's the reason why we're debating about nitrofurantoin so much. So
yes, in the last, I think last 9 months, after 36 weeks, we are not using nitrofurantoin. The chances of having intracranial hemorrhage, this is the drug which are not used in the late trimester, we can use in the early trimester. The metronidazole, we can't use in the first trimester, but use in the second and third trimester.
Second trimester.
So the various things we have to take them.
Perfect. Fine.
Yeah.
So we keep that in mind, and also keep that in mind that the sulfonamides and the nitrofurantoin will induce the glucose-6-phosphate dehydrogenase deficiency in the last trimester. So 37 weeks around delivery, we will not use them. And much before that, they are quite safe. So that point taken. And we have a new drug called fosfomycin, which can also be used in pregnancy if UTI.
Yes.
And so we have the option. I did not want to put a case of UTI because I'm sure that the August audience will know that. And so we will go on for something a little more difficult and different. And Leela ma'am, this is for you to start with, followed by Dr. Renu Makwana. She's a 34-year-old, married for 6 years, IT professional, treated for primary infertility for 3 years by Dr. Apurva. And then she's come to Chennai and she's conceived by UTI and is now 10 weeks pregnant. And she comes to us with a report of oral glucose tolerance test elevated, and she's referred here for further management after diet control, and her sugars are not still settled. And so she wants to know, what drug can I take? She's only 10 weeks and she's a 34-year-old, well-read IT professional, and she's 10 weeks of pregnancy now. So what do you think? She's a GYN now. And so what is the drug you will think in terms of after diet control, Dr. Leela Vyas, ma'am?
Yes. If we go with the ideal way, the insulin is the first drug of choice. We go with that. That is the safety. But the, now the studies are coming with the metformin also. But still, as the government of India, the guideline, they have given that you start after 20 weeks of the pregnancy. So looking towards her scenario, that 34 years old, long infertility, maybe a case of PCOD, and having that more sugar is control is required. IT professional, definitely she is having a very sedentary life. I think that for her, the insulin should be the drug of choice in this case, particularly a high-risk case and with the long infertility. So Apurva will be happy with the our treatment, I think so.
Fine. She's diagnosed at 10 weeks only, so she cannot be GDF. It will be pre-existing also.
Fine. When she's diagnosed for the first time, let's not talk of screening and diagnosis of GDF.
Okay. But once diagnosed in pregnancy, it is considered as the pregnancy.
Agreed. Let's not argue on that. Our debate is not on that today. Our debate.
Okay. Yeah.
So now anybody wants to say that insulin is because she's. She is always on the Google, and she will also know of options, and she will say, I can't have the injections, and so can I have a tablet? And so definitely she's going to ask you the question. And Dr. Renu Makwan, what do you want to do now? Agree with Dr. Leela Vyas and go ahead or start some other drug and think in terms of metformin, or what is your choice? More so, she can be a PCO also. So what is the
We can start metformin also. Metformin.
At 10 weeks.
Yes.
Perfect, Dr. Renu. I like you for that. Okay. So, not for diabetes in pregnancy was a old myth, and meant for women pregnancy, new dictum. And Dr. Neeraj, what are your thoughts on that? Why not metformin? Why should you think that we're not going to give metformin?
No, we can definitely give metformin now. With so many studies now, it is established that it is a safer to give metformin. There is no issue with metformin. So we can give it.
Okay, fine. So here we have answers to say why not metformin. It's an insulin sensitizer, and that is exactly the problem with this particular lady, because I'm sure she had PCO, and it decreases gluconeogenesis, decreases hyperglycemia, decreases fatty acid oxidation, does not cause hypoglycemia. Get the point clear. And lactic acidosis is a complication we need to keep in mind, but it's only 1 in 1,000 cases of lactic acidosis, so which has never happened. And it's a theoretical side effect, lactic acidosis, just like how paracetamol causing hypothermia. I'm sure all of us use paracetamol, the COVID vaccine. How many of us have got into a temperature of 94 and 95? Definitely no. Same way lactic acidosis, and it's contraindicated renal disease. We need to keep that in caution. You can go on till 2 to 2.5 milligrams, 2.5 grams per day. And so that's what we could go on, especially this particular lady. And there is, Dr. Prerna, would you want to say metformin? Does it cross the placenta? And what are your catalysts?
Yes. I would like to say about metformin. It decreases the glucose absorption in the intestine. So that is one of the points which was missing in previous slide.
It will come in the next few slides. Don't worry. Yeah. Perfect. Anyway, I'm happy you brought that point out. Yeah, what do you think is the placental?
Yeah, metformin does cross the placenta barrier. Yes. It's been seen in this thing, and it has been, there's enough data now. We have this metformin is very safe drug, and in this lady, I would definitely go with the metformin, because taking an injectable insulin, it won't be advisable. In this case, when the patient is very literate, that time we must talk to the patient, proper counseling is done, and we should be able to tell them this is the advantage of insulin, this is the advantage of oral anti-diabetic drug. And in this case, I would definitely go for metformin. I've been using metformin since so many, this thing being an infertility specialist. So right from the first trimester, I will put her on metformin, yes.
Perfect. Thank you very much, madam. That was fantastic. And so, although it crosses the placenta, it is a class B drug. And please understand that insulin is also a class B drug, and metformin also is a class B drug. And now I'm just going to ask you a question. I don't have a slide here because I wantedly did not put it. What do you think is the idea of teratogenicity of metformin when we start in that 31 to 71 day period? What do you think is the idea of teratogenicity a metformin can produce?
Teratogenicity is basically because of the poor glycemic control, not because of the metformin.
Right.
Okay, that is a beautiful answer, Neeraj. I thought you would say it with more, little more drama, but anyway, the answer came so simple. Gluck study, which came in, and the Picardo study, which came in with very few numbers of 50 type 2 diabetes with metformin usage and then congenital anomaly. It was actually the poor glycemic which caused the congenital abnormalities and not metformin. At that point, the study came in, we did not know. Only after studies in 2000, these studies were dredged out and we got the data that, oh, it was not the innocent metformin, it was something else. What was that? That was the sugar control, and that is what produced the congenital abnormalities and not metformin. So it will probably not produce teratogenicity at all. So
that's why the particularly in this case I was mentioning, because we require a control of sugar control very nicely. The reason being, she is a high-risk patient. Age factor is also associated with that. And 10 weeks diagnosis means maybe have hyperglycemia, because we have not done HbA1c in this patient. It may be raised, and that may be the cause, and that's why we can go with the insulin in this patient. Otherwise, the metformin is a good drug, and it gives, yes, slightly less sugar control if diet and all is there. Purely GDM, then it's a very good drug.
Thank you.
There is a backup of some studies. Like there were studies which were done, randomized trial were done, where the patients who were on for PCOS, they were on metformin. And then they, like the pregnancy, after pregnancy, the same drugs were continued.
Yeah,
in the
you're
first
just putting
trimester.
On the slide
and,
here.
Yeah.
You just need to see the slide, the Gluck
okay,
trial.
Okay,
yeah.
okay.
This lady is only 10 weeks and she's a potential candidate to have a miscarriage. But when a patient is on metformin, the incidence of spontaneous miscarriages reduced from 73% to 10%.
Total, yes.
Out of this as well. And she's a case of PCO. Maybe we are not going to the infertile detail. And so that's another advantage which metformin adds on. And now the next question I'm going to ask Dr. Renu, is metformin potential to cause hypoglycemia, which is a difficult task with insulin?
Yeah,
No, as such, there is no incidences of hypoglycemia seen with metformin, which is more.
So that is a very clear answer. No, it does not produce hypoglycemia. Like what I said, paracetamol causing hypothermia. Yes, it doesn't do at all, though it's a theoretical side effect. And it does not cause hypoglycemia. And with PCO patients, I'm sure all of you use 1 gram of metformin, maybe off the label, on the label, whatever, but then it does not cause that. And that's why we are free to use metformin in PCO patients. And so it does not cause glycemia.
It causes GI disturbances like bloating, nausea.
Perfect.
That is at times very difficult to manage, but as such, hypoglycemia is. No.
Yes. Because its basic action is to sensitize the muscle for the insulin. So
perfect.
Incidence of hypoglycemia is very less or
perfect.
Not there.
No, there is no hypoglycemia at all. There's no.
No. Yes, yes.
Now the next question I'm just going to ask you is between the two drugs, which drug would you think you are bothered about in an obese patient, metformin or insulin? And how do you think it affects obesity in a patient? Like what you're seeing on the video, if you're able to see that.
Metformin is much better.
Perfect. Okay, fine. So insulin treatment further worsens the obesity by competing with the insulin-like growth factors. That was the beautiful Langer trial, which came in after 2000, in 2006. And glibenclamide or metformin therapy in obese patients will result in better pregnancy outcome than insulin, which worsens obesity. And you now have the recent Empower trial, which I did not quote. So for an obese PCO or obese pregnant patient, like the ones which Dr. Noser was operating, if they were diabetic, probably metformin would be a better drug than insulin. Now, I didn't expect, I thought Dr. Sharma was mentioning about the randomized control trial that the proof of the pudding was the metformin and gestational diabetes trial where the New Zealand trial came out some time back. And I'm sure Dr. Jaydeep would agree that we were in New Zealand when the trial was out for the AVFOC conference. And the MIG trial came back after that. And what do you think is the evidence of the MIG trial, metformin and gestational diabetes trial, which came out? Dr. Neeraj, do you want to tell on the MIG trial?
No, I'm not sure about the MIG trial.
Yes, I'm missing Dr. Preeti and Dr. Panda. I'm sure they've still not joined anyway. Fine. Dr. Renu, do you want to go on the MIG trial?
So parenteral complications with metformin use in the second phase. So it was RCT on the use of metformin in the second, third trimester. And there is no difference in primary composite endpoints. Glycemic control was better with metformin group as compared to insulin. And obviously patient compliance was good and mother found it very convenient instead of taking insulin.
And we always have the habit of telling that the trials were very small. This was a randomized control trial, multicentric studies in all over the world, including the Indian population. And there were 3,000 women in the group. And so the numbers were not small. And this came out after the HAPO trial. And so we had enough evidence that metformin was quite okay. And then there were enough critics who said, were the babies followed up after the metformin MIG trial? Yes, the baby followed after the MIG trial, and we had the TOFU trial or the offspring follow-up trial where the babies were followed up for 2 years and the babies did not have any adiposity or the babies did not look fat. It was called as the MIG TOFU trial, which is not a very old trial, and the findings were very reassuring for clinicians and especially the newborn people, the neonatologists, to say that we could use metformin very safely during pregnancy. OHAs were always endorsed by enough evidences, and now we have the NICE guidelines 2017, if I'm correct, to say that we have metformin to be endorsed usage in first, second or third trimester, doesn't matter. But in labor, let's be very cautious that in labor, we cannot stop metformin because our titration of dosage will be easier with insulin, especially if she's a overt diabetic patient, not a GDM, but a diabetic patient becoming going into labor. Probably your insulin is better to titrate rather than metformin. And having spoken so much about metformin, we need to be cautious about that. And I'm sure coming back to the questions of three cases are over. I'm just going to ask each one of you to say, what is your choice of antihypertensives? Dr. Renu, what do you want to use in pregnancy? What is that you will not use? And then we will move on to one more slide and then we will probably end the if there are questions.
Yeah. Usually methyl dopa is the choice, but nowadays we don't get it. And nowadays labetalol is the choice of drug during pregnancy.
What is the choice you will not use? That is what our audience is going to be interested in.
ACE inhibitor we won't use.
ACE inhibitors and ARBs are something which we will not use of fetal teratogenicity, whereas you could use labetalol, nifedipine, alpha methyl dopa, propranolol, no evidence of teratogenicity at all. So let's not be worried, but when you use ACE inhibitors, oligamnios, fetal limb contractures, cranial anomalies and hypoplastic lung development are something which you need to be bothered with kidney function as well. And so that is something which we need to be worried. And so you will not use them during pregnancy. But when we deliver a patient, we probably can think in terms of amlodipine and start using ACE inhibitors, which are not a problem while lactation. Coming and never be the first to use the new nor the last to use the old. It's an old statement. And here are a few drugs which I will just go through. And that's very, very obvious that these are the neonatal affection and comment and cytotoxic drugs, multiple anomalies, steroids, masculinization, stilbestrol, banned drug, lithium, cardiovascular anomalies, anticonvulsants you have, we've read. Aspirin is a drug which we've been using very commonly, and high doses is what has been supposed to cause premature closure of patent ductus arteriosus. The dosage what we use is between 80 and 150, and so that is nothing at all. Paracetamol, too small to be harmful. Antimalarials, chloroquine, quinine, no evidence of fetal toxicity. Steroids, definitely only prednisolone high doses may produce problems. Otherwise, we've been using steroids left and right. Aminoglycosides, arterial vestibular damage, chloramphenicol, gravy. So these are the drugs which we did go through, metronidazole, nitrofurantoin, ACE inhibitors, vitamin K, and all live viral vaccines, including the COVID vaccine are potentially dangerous to the fetus. Narcotics, yes, depression of the CNS and anesthetic agents, we need to be cautious in usage. And now let me ask the panelists to say one line and we would end on with the panel if Dr. Apurva and Dr. Jaydeep approves me to do that. Dr. Leela Vyas, madam, yes.
Finally, yes, prescription during pregnancy, one is the important part. Looking towards means all the high-risk cases, the late age is already associated with some teratogenicity. So we take care of that. And second point is the one is the litigation, which is again, one is very important part because everyone is going with the Google and all. And if they find and they read that leaflet and if the educated mass is coming, then it's, yes, it's a very sincere responsibility of all obstetrician to prescribe any drug in the pregnancy.
Thank you, ma'am. Perfect. Dr. Reno.
So it always good to go with guidelines because patients are also aware and especially during treating UTI during pregnancy. So if we prescribe something, they will go to guidelines. So it's always good to go with guidelines, monotherapy as well, and no unnecessary prescriptions for antibiotics.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Reno. Dr. Sharma, would you want to say something at the end of the panel before we end up?
Yeah. So be rational in treatment. I am very sure that all of us are very much, we are very much affectionate with our pregnant patient. Like if we are treating a pregnancy, it is like something art thing for us. So try, keep updating yourself, be rational in treatment. And prescription is one of the signature sign of your persona as an obstetrician. So take care of it.
Perfect. Dr. Prerna?
Yeah, while writing a prescription for a pregnant lady, I think one should be very meticulous. Most of the normal ailments, we should try to convince them that it should not be, unless it's bothering her, then only we should give her medicine. Unless the illness is like something like diabetes and all this, in those cases, we have to give medicine, but small cold and cough and all, we try to do this thing. And many a times in my practice, I tell them to try with the household remedies, which works 50% of time. For the small ailments, but for in case of infection, yeah, we do prescribe the antibiotic with a pinch of salt and with a meticulous manner. Yeah,
thank you, Dr. Neeraj, the man, and I'm missing Dr. Panda and Dr. Preeti Jindal. Dr. Neeraj, yeah,
before prescribing, always think twice. I am doing a any harm or I am doing any favor to the patient. So always give that thought before patting any thing during pregnancy. And that's it.
It's exactly the style of Dr. Panyanappal.
That is the thank you very much. What I just wanted to say is that from phenytoin we've changed to levetiracetam or lamotrigine for convulsions, and we've changed to low molecular weight.
Yes.
And please understand and appreciate the fact that change is the only constant, and that's what the superstar of Tamil Nadu always says, and this is a song which goes on for the Tamil viewers who are here, very few of them, Maatram Ondrudhaan Maaradhu Maaru. So change, and that is the only constant, and we have changed a lot in our prescription writing and in our practice and in our evidence as well. And thank you very much for the wonderful panel and for the fantastic deliberation we've been having, and thank you Dr. Jaydeep, Dr. Parikshit and Dr. Apurva for this wonderful O to S series, and I'm sure I finished well in time, and if there are questions we are happy to answer, and thank you very much for this opportunity. Thank you panelists.
Yes.
Thank you
very much Palaniappan for as usual a wonderful panel, and your last slide, of course I always look forward to those slides of yours. But I must admit that my current favorite right now is Master with Let Me Tell You a Kutti Story, and I quite
we'll use
like
it in the next one definitely.
I like the Vati coming theme also, very nice. So let me also thank all the panelists, Dr. Renu Makwana, Dr. Prerna, Neeraj, of course Dr. Leela Vyas, whom I have had such a pleasure working with for her entire duration of tenure in FOCSI, and Dr. Pranjal Sharma. I'm sorry that some of the other panelists could not make it for various reasons. Apurva, are you here? There are a few questions, I think, quite interesting number of questions. And Palaniappan, you know, one of the indices that I use to decide or to know how interesting the panel was and the session was is whether there were more people at the end of the session than at the beginning. And I'm happy to tell you that there were several more people at the end of this session. In fact, we currently have 5,097 delegates logged in.
Congratulations.
That's very nice, Jaydeep. That's a dessert to today's dinner. Thank you.
And let me just share the screen. Somebody, Dr. Nitya, wanted to know the chart which we use for the Pitocin in the infusion pump. So that's the chart for those who would like. I have also WhatsApped this picture to Dr. Nitya. Dr. Nitya, I hope you have received it. I just spoke to you some time back. And I will remove this chart in another few seconds, and then Dr. Palaniappan, there are some questions for you. Okay, I'm going to remove the chart. If anybody wants it, please feel free to WhatsApp me. I'll be happy to share the chart. So Dr. Palaniappan, there are a few questions, in fact, and we will take some time to answer those questions.
Thank you so much for a wonderful session, sir. Shall we take a couple of questions more, sir?
No, yeah, Apurva, take all the questions. That's not a problem.
Hello?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Take all the questions, Apurva. They are quite interesting, actually.
Yes. Perfect, sir. So I think we will start with Dr. Radha from Erode. I think she's also again requested to start. Dr. Nitya from Erode again. We have a lot of people from Erode today. She's, thank you, Jerry, sir. Dr. Vanita has also requested for the, sorry. Dr. Vanita has asked, chickenpox in first trimester, how to manage? Vanita, can you hear me? I think Dr.
Yes. I am able to hear you. That's going to be a essay question to be answered, Dr. Chickenpox in first semester. I will request Dr. Nithya to call me or talk to me. I will tell her how to manage. We are having some
Yes, Dr. Vani, I think you can get in touch directly with Palani sir. Sir will be able to help you with respect to management. Dr. Radha again has commented that it's a good and simply clinically oriented presentation that we are having. Dr. Sunila Naidu from Vishakhapatnam has asked use of indomethacin in hyramyas.
Perfect. We will call it as medical
lineup
amniocentesis, and we do we were using it some time back for the simple reason of polyhydramnios using it, and indomethacin has a wonderful gastric irritation effect, and that is the best potent gastric irritant we can ever have, and can produce blood vomiting, blood whatever, hemoptysis, hematemesis, whatever. And so we made something called as pessaries, which could use rectal pessaries, 25 milligrams, and is available. And we still use it at very rare situations when we want to do decrease the liquor for fear of only respiratory distress produced by the polyhydramnios. Otherwise, we never use. It is definitely better than amniocentesis and reduction, but then now the NICU rates and the salvageability rates have come up very well. And so probably we will deliver them babies 31, 32, 33, whatever we will deliver them. So its use is not abandoned. So we are not worried about use. It is not a teratogenic drug we can still use. It is a drug which will produce side effect, but not teratogenicity.
We'll stop
so
it.
Would you recommend...
I wouldn't select.
We'll stop it quite before.
Yeah, Dr. Pranjali, can go on.
We can stop it just 2 weeks before or before at 36 weeks with the fear of the closure of premature closure of ductus. Indomethacin, we have to stop. Yes.
Sure. Dr. Shubhalakshmi from Trivandrum has joined. Thank you so much, Dr. Dr. Saraswati Krishnamurthy from Ernakulam. Patients who conceive on ACE inhibitors and detect pregnancy after 45 days gestation, can the pregnancy be continued?
Yes, the pregnancy can be continued for the very simple reason we do not know what anomalies it could produce. But any drug for the percentage which we said is only 2 to 3%. So we can only take a chance at this moment, stop the ACE inhibitors and start them on some other antihypertensive which we are comfortable with, maybe labetalol or whatever drug, and then only wait for pregnant abnormalities and then look. So that risk is something which we have to think in terms of and not say go abort the baby, because the risk of the anomaly is much lesser than what we think in terms of. And so we need to counsel the patient and go a little slow on that rather than offer her termination of pregnancy.
Sure. I think madam has another question. If patient develops hyperglycemia later while on metformin and insulin has to be added, should metformin be withheld?
And I didn't get the question, Apurva, once more.
So if a patient is hyperglycemic and she's on, if she's a GDM, if she's a GDM on metformin and later insulin has to be added in order to, improve the glucose levels.
Perfect. That's a beautiful question. Yeah, I congratulate the person who's asked the question. Very nice. It adds.
Dr. Saraswati Krishnamurthy.
Dr. Saraswati, thank you very much for asking that question. So after 2 grams of metformin, probably metformin may not act very well. Just like how after 40, 50 units of insulin may not produce, it will cause insulin resistance rather than act. So we would add metformin. So in the same way with 2 grams of metformin and more than that, the sugars are not controlled. Insulin is probably the choice of addition. So please add insulin and don't. That is where insulin scores over metformin. And so use insulin as
but the reserve. But should we withhold metformin after starting, sir?
No. Don't withhold metformin. Okay. Because your usage of insulin will come down if you use metformin along with insulin. So use the same dosage of metformin what you were using and add on insulin, whatever use dosage which you want. Keep your sugar levels between 100 pre-meal and 130 post-meal.
Right. Dr. Kiran Sinha from Kanpur has asked any time interval between metformin and breastfeeding.
Time interval? No, you can take.
I mean, can we have metformin? I think, yeah.
Yes, you can give during lactation, absolutely safe. And there are diabetologists who prescribe metformin after the baby's deliver. And so generally, we
wait
on that.
I think the concern is after we consume the pill, how long should we have the duration before?
No time limit. Metformin is to be taken along with food. That's all is the only concern. So because it will be good. It doesn't cause hypoglycemia, but action of metformin,
sure,
very good with the food. And so the sugar levels are kept very well. That's all is the issue. So breastfeeding timing doesn't matter at all.
Sure. Dr. Yashodhara from Nellore has commented that for UTI, I think it's best to avoid nitrofurantoin as the first line of option, even in second trimester, because we have to keep in as an option for resistant and recurrent UTIs. Any comments, sir?
There are debates using nitrofurantoin for the very simple reason. One, they produce vomiting equivalent to that of hypertensis gravidarum. So we need to be cautious about nitrofurantoin also. So that's a point which we didn't bring about. And so that's one point. And two, with second trimester, it's quite safe. And it has been approved as a first line drug in asymptomatic bacteria and symptomatic. So, and we could think in terms of vancomycin, which is a new drug also. So it would prefer on the choice, but it's not a bad drug to use in second trimester because we have enough evidence to use it as the first line drug.
Sure. Dr. Anjali Sood from Delhi has asked, can we give fosamycin?
Yes, we can. I did mention about it second time, third.
Yes.
Sachet. Now it's available.
Perfect. Dr. Kiran Sinha of Kanpur has asked, we will definitely go for HbA1c in case of diabetes before pregnancy and also required for anomaly and counseling if it is raised.
I agree.
So what would you say as the cutoff for HbA1c?
HbA1c, it's beyond the panel, but anyway, I will answer that question. We would be happier with a HbA1c of 6 to 6.5 and a HbA1c of 7, that we need to put a little bit good control, and above 8 is very poor control. Above 9, adverse pregnancy outcome is 20%. Above 10, adverse pregnancy outcome is 40%. Above 11, I would probably prefer termination of pregnancy.
Dr. Kiran has said from Kanpur has said regarding the safety of fosamycin in pregnancy, and Dr. Tanuja from Nellore has asked that if in one case of epilepsy, what is the drug of choice in the first trimester?
I think I would start with levetiracetam rather than ferritroin.
Levetiracetam, yes. I think even Dr. Vanita has agreed to that. Dr. Lakshmi Shrikande, ma'am, thank you so much for joining in. She's congratulated Jaideep sir, Noza sir, and Palani sir for excellent lectures. Dr. Alka from Amravati has again congratulated all of you, Noza sir, Jaideep sir, and Palani sir. And she's congratulated us. Dr. Nitya has again asked, from E-Road has asked, role of Fortwin in augmentation of labor.
Is that to Dr. Jaideep?
Is that
he's there? Yeah,
Jaideep sir, yes.
So the role of Fortwin in augmentation of labor is actually quite controversial, if I may say so. And to tell you the truth, Fortwin has more of an effect in terms of pain relief rather than augmentation. The theory being that if the patient feels a lesser amount of pain, she will be able to tolerate the labor a little longer and give a little better chance for normal delivery. I'm not really sure that there is any evidence to show that administration of Fortwin accelerates labor in any way. So I hope that answers the question. Dr. Radha Rangaswamy, I'm unable to get your mobile number. You wanted the oxytocin chart, but I'm unable to have your mobile number. Madam, my number is available on the FOXI website. If you could please send me a WhatsApp, I'll send you the oxytocin chart. Thank you.
Awesome. I think we have just Dr. Jyotika Desai from Bangalore has joined us, and again, congratulated the entire team. Thank you so much for joining, ma'am. With that, I think this is the first time we've taken so many questions, 40 questions, and been very well in time.
Dr. Priya Karmani also has asked one quick last question. Torch infection in pregnancy. Jaideep sir, I think Dr. Radha has messaged the number. I think we can pick it up from here.
Okay.
Palni sir, do you want to take this?
Torch infection? Yeah, I can take it. If you're thinking in terms of torch screening in recurrent pregnancy loss, I would answer the way Dr. Pailey answers. It's a decent burial amen. We never do torch panel for recurrent abortions. But if it is going to be infection in pregnancy and then causing congenital abnormalities, yes, it can produce congenital abnormalities, microcephaly, etc., it can produce. And we have very select antiviral drugs to use. And syphilis is almost gone now. So we would use any penicillin group of drugs to treat them. Rovomycin is a drug which we can use. And so we can treat them, but congenital abnormalities are quite common with the drugs which you use, and of course a torch infection as well. And so it is quite a dirty infection to have for anomalies. So let's not talk of miscarriages. Anomalies, yes, they can produce congenital anomalies.
So quickly, I think we will take three questions. So because I kind of really like these questions, Dr. Shubhangi has asked antibiotics during routine procedures like cesarean. If we can have a rapid fire, Palani sir.
The recommendation is that from the NIHA, we would give a single dose clean cut incision, single dose of any cefazolin or third generation cephalosporin before clamping the cord. And that's the recommendation for a clean cut elective cesarean section for a breach of whatever you're doing. If in different case scenarios, yes, we would use it accordingly. If it's a GDM or a PPROM, etc., we would use anything else like an erythromycin or amoxicillin clavulanic acid. So these are the usual recommendations. I'll make it short.
Great. Dr. Shaurabh from Shampa has asked, second gravida, 6 weeks, 5 days, HbA1c 8.4, FBS is 200, should we start her with insulin or metformin?
After the discussion, you could go on with whatever. I think I will start.
with you would say insulin, sir?
I would say metformin. If anybody on insulin, we can, the debate will always be on. Yeah. And we leave it to the Jaideep to answer that.
Right. Jaideep, sir, any comments?
No, thank you. Thank you, Apurva. As you said, we have never had, such a long question and answer session. And I think that's a tribute to the wonderful way in which the panel was.
So I think this one question I have to ask, when pregnancy be continued after taking Mifigest or Misoprostol?
Oh.
Palani, you want to get that?
Yes, I can. Depends on the dosage of mifepristone, and there are enough people who use mifepristone for induction of labor. So it's not going to be the 600 milligrams of mifepristone. We use it as 200. So you could continue pregnancy with the mifepristone. Not in the first trimester after if you're taking it for a miscarriage, medical abortion, that's a different story.
Yes,
so
I think that's the question, sir. In case if you're using it for miscarriage.
Okay, so the anomalies associated with mifepristone, is that the question? Yes, I would be cautious and I would counsel her and then think in terms of anomalies and think in terms of termination rather than continuation of pregnancy.
I think when you said mifepristone and misoprostol, Nozer switched on his video camera. Nozer, would you like to, Nozer, would you like to add something?
Yeah, I think it's very clear that there have been moves to try and salvage pregnancies after mifepristone, misoprostol are used, particularly misoprostol. There's a whole move by the anti-abortion lobby to kind of recommend high doses of progestrogens. But when a woman makes a decision to go in for a medical abortion, that decision is an absolute decision, because there is evidence to show that you can have birth defects, particularly when it's used in that time in the first trimester. So no question. I just wanted to touch upon one more thing. I know we discussed this earlier. I do selectively use mifepristone in difficult inductions with normal life pregnancies. So if I have a Bishop score, which is very poor, and I don't have, and I definitely want to induce her and try and go for a normal delivery, I do use 200 milligrams of mifepristone. There is evidence, there is a Cochrane database supporting it. We still need to build up more evidence, but there's enough to back us up.
I agree, Doza. Can I just say that what I was speaking on was for augmentation?
Yeah, that's why I said no. So then most of my inductions start with PGE2. Usually I go up to 3 gels, don't stop at 2. And then I very often move on to misoprostol. That comes in for augmentation. I don't stay on misoprostol for a very long time. It's just to take them between the gel and the oxytocin, like Jaideep said. It's usually 25 micrograms every 3 or 4 hourly. The moment she hits the 3 or 4 centimeters, that's when an ERM happens, epidural happens, and oxytocin comes in. Now, my purpose of using PGE2 and misoprostol is the patient doesn't start an IV till that time. This process could be going on for 12 hours, 18 hours, even longer. And psychologically, for a woman, when I tell her that I'm using drugs which are akin to very much of what normal labor has, after all, prostaglandins are the start of normal labor and the progress, patients feel very comfortable and confident to wait for a very long time. So the IV comes in only when I'm starting her, when I'm doing the moment the ERM happens and the epidural happens, Jaideep, I get onto oxytocin exactly like you said, and then titrate it. One word of caution. If you're using mifepristone, your uterus is now super sensitive. Please use lower doses of oxytocin. And I'm not saying less oxytocin. It's always 5 units, but lower drip rates of oxytocin, because your uterus now is very sensitive and tachycystole and hypertonus can happen very, very easily. So like you were told in that lecture, particularly with augmentation, every patient is different. Every situation is different. Every pregnancy is different. And while your basic principles remain the same, be prepared to modify on a patient-to-patient basis.
Thank you. Thank you, Rosa. Apurva, I think...
Thank you so much, sir.
We can now continue the session.
Yes, I think the questions will continue to keep pouring, but this has been such an amazing session, such a great landmark with all the wonderful speakers, 5,000 delegates, 20th session, and you know, more than 40 questions answered. This has been a true rapid fire, and thank you so much everyone for joining in, and have a very good night.
Good night, everybody.